everybody. Welcome to a Rik Look, also known as a Quick Look, just a quick look at a game that I've been playing. It's just, you know, usually just an hour or so. I haven't completed it or anything like that, but that's the nature of a Rik Look video. And today we're looking at Space Hulk Deathwing. Now, this is a first-person shooter. It has a strong online co-op element. I guess what I mean by that is that it was designed partly for that, but it's also got a single player campaign with AI companions, and it is part of the Warhammer 40,000 universe, and it's based on the Space Hulk board game. Now, if you're not familiar with that board game, or indeed the Warhammer 40,000 world, or even if you're just interested and you do have some familiarity with it, I'll just try and give you a quick background of what this game is about, because if you know anything about the Warhammer 40k universe, it is huge. There is books and books and books of stuff about this place, this fictional place, so I'll try and keep this brief. So, in a nutshell, we are in the 41st millennium, so it, for context, obviously we're in the second millennium right now, in year 2016, so we are talking like the year 40,000 and something. It's very, very far in the future. And in a very brief nutshell, the human race is now colonized most of the Milky Way, and it's in a vast, sprawling imperium. Well, an empire referred to as the Imperium, with billions and billions of worlds out there now. So there are spacecraft and aliens, and it's a bad, bad place. The tagline for the Warhammer 40k universe is, in the grim darkness there is only war. So that gives you an indication of this is not a nice future. This is not a beautiful future. It's all horrible, and there's a lot of misery, to be honest. But anyway, the Imperium, the billions and billions of worlds, the countless humans that are out there, is essentially beset on all sides by aliens and demons and all sorts of things, which I won't bore you with. Now, what that means is the Imperium has a incredibly vast military, and the elite of the military are the Space Marines, and these are genetically engineered super soldiers. They're like 7 foot tall, they have two hearts, three lungs, they're super strong, super fast, very hard to kill. Even if you do really, really hurt them, they just kind of shut down into a coma until they can be healed and fight again. They fight in powerful armor, which is, well, it's got power armor, and that is attached to them. That is kind of their nervous system works with it, and in a nutshell, they're hard as nails, and they're super elite. Now, there's only there's not very many of these elite soldiers, the Space Marines, and they are organized into what are called chapters, which I guess you could, you know, in traditional terms, like regiments of units, and these chapters all have their own name, and these chapters of Space Marines, they are all completely autonomous. They look after themselves. They don't necessarily report to anybody. They just go around doing what they want, as long as it's in the interests of serving the Imperium and doing what's right and protecting and killing the bad guys as the way they see it. Okay, so there's loads of these different chapters, 1,000 I think if I remember, and each one of these chapters has 1,000 Marines in it, and those Marines are split up into different, I guess, battalions, to smaller troops of 100 units, 100 soldiers each, and the very, very elite of the Space Marines are called the First Company. So in each one of these chapters there's a First Company, and they wear special armor, which is even tougher than the normal power armor, and that's called Terminator armor, and that's what we are. That's what I was getting to the point. So we are playing as the elite of the elite within the Space Marines, and we're playing as the Space Marine chapter, the Dark Angels, and their elite unit is called the Deathwing, hence we have Space Hulk Deathwing. Now, what is a Space Hulk? So, a Space Hulk, so in the 40k universe, obviously we've got space craft going around space, and, you know, if you watch Star Trek, they use warp drives to get around, to go faster than light. If you watch Star Wars, they use a hyperlight drive or whatever it is, to go faster than light. In the 40k universe, because everything's a bit grimmer and darker and more horrible, it's not as nice as that. What they do is they go into another dimension, which is referred to as the Immaterium, or is sometimes called the Warp, and essentially it's hell, for all intents and purposes. They go into this other dimension. It's full of demons and nasties and horrible things. But the advantage of the Immaterium is that time and space doesn't really apply, which means they can travel vast distances in short periods of time. Now, what can happen is that these spacecraft, when they go into the Immaterium, they can sometimes get lost, they can sometimes disappear, they can have engine failures, whatever, and they just get lost in the Immaterium, never to be seen again. Now, if you imagine hundreds of spaceships getting lost in the Immaterium, drifting around there, they can sometimes crash into each other in the Immaterium and meld together. Now, if you imagine, you know, 50, 60, 1,000, 2,000 spacecraft of all different shapes and sizes, all different ages, you know, some are from thousands of years ago, some are modern, some are from alien races, some are from human spacecraft, etc., etc., and they all just smash together in the Immaterium, and they are all melded together into one huge spaceship made up of loads of different ships, and that is called a Space Hulk. And what happens is every now and again, the Immaterium will just spit out the Space Hulk into normal space, and it will just float around. Now, the Space Hulk, or Space Hulks as they are known in the world, you know, these are rife with prizes, artifacts, new technology, old technology, and they are both incredibly priceless to the Imperium and Space Marines and everybody, really, because they're full of all these secrets, but they're also incredibly dangerous because they could be full of demons, they could be full of experiments. Maybe one of these spaceships was like carrying weird prototype monsters or weird technology, who knows. So that's what a Space Hulk is. Now, what we do in this game is a Space Hulk has emerged into real space, and we, as I say, are the we are the Dark Angels Space Marine chapter, and we have turned up to help deal with this. But there is also a alien race called the Tyranids nearby, who are attacking a nearby system. And the Tyranids, I won't bore you with that, but essentially the Tyranids, if you've seen Starship Troopers, they're like the bug aliens out of that, or maybe if you play StarCraft, they're like the Zerg, they're like insects, essentially, with a hive mind, and they're very dangerous and very horrible and relentless, and all they want to do is consume and eat everything, and there are millions and millions of them, and the Tyranids are attacking a nearby system. So the Dark Angels en masse are going to help that out, but what they've done is that they've left the Deathwing, the elite unit, behind to have a look at the Space Hulk, essentially. So that's what we're doing in this game. So I won't bore you with any more lore, because we could make an entire video on that, but that's what we're doing and that's where we are. So if you've never seen or played any 40k or done anything, then I think that's just a little primer of what the hell is going on when we start this. So we're going to give this a go. As I say, we'll just do maybe the first level, maybe have a look at the second level. And yeah, so here we go. So we'll watch the introduction first, which should hopefully ratify some of the stuff I've just told you. I guess there is just one last thing to add. Space Marines, and indeed throughout the Imperium and everywhere, there are psykers. They're basically wizards, you know, for want of a better description. They're like space wizards. They can do magical powers for all intents and purposes, but they're called psykers in the 40k universe, and a space marine psyker is called a librarian. So when you hear anything about a librarian, and that's actually who we play as, we are a librarian, that is what it's talking about. So off we go, new campaign, let's see how we get on. So,
this is Grandmaster Belial, addressing all warriors of the First Company.
He's the leader of the Dark Angels.
Forged from countless ships in the seething forces of warp space, a space hulk has been deposited here by the uncaring tides of the Immaterium. I have dubbed this drifting lair of abominations Olethros.
It's a bit dramatic.
A hive swarm of tyrannids already besets the system. So while the honored warriors of the Deathwing embark upon the purging of this space hulk, our brothers shall assist the Astra Militarum and Imperial Navy in destroying this tendril of the Great Devourer.
So that's the rest of the Dark Angels off to fight that.
Belongs to an epistolary of the Librarian.
Yeah.
A deadly battle psyker of the chapter.
Space Wizard.
Leading a specially assembled squad, the Librarian will investigate abnormal augur returns and psychic energy.
So here you go, here's what the Space Marines look like in the Terminator armor, which is bigger, tougher armor than the normal armor they wear. Reserved for the First Company.
The ether gifts me visions. I see a threat far more deadly than gene-hungry tyrants. A scream, and a dark promise. A ship in the shadow, a relic from our secret past. I feel the tightness in my gut as I see a cataclysm as yet unseen. The Umbra Mortalis descends upon us. The shadow of death.
So our librarian,
brothers,
who we are,
scans of the space hulk,
thinks there's something bad going on here.
Dark angel ship that dates back to the age of heresy. It is located in the heart of the Olethros space hulk. This ship from our ancestors seems to be protected by a mysterious energy field. Teleportation to the ship is currently impossible. The only way to reach it is through the main mass of the space hulk. Reaching this ship is your primary concern.
That's what we'll be doing.
Trust your battle brothers to deal with the rest of the Olethros.
So, how we are delivered to the space hulk, which is that huge monstrosity there, is through these. They're called boarding torpedoes. So they are full of the elite First Company. And they're all landing in different parts of the ship. The different parts of the space hulk, I should say. So here we are on board our boarding torpedo. So we're in space at the minute. These are servo skills. They just maintain and scan things. And so this is me, and we have my two colleagues here, my two battle brothers is the proper terminology in 40k lore. And this is what you can hear and see is the boarding torpedo kind of grinding through, so it has a big drill on the front and it drills through spacecraft, because they use them to attack other spacecraft and then disgorge space marines in there, and essentially like a boarding action like in old pirate films. What you can see there is a sword. Okay, so here's the briefing.
Brother Librarian, the initial boarding strike is proceeding, but we have lost contact with Squad Gideon.
Ah, Squad Gideon.
The Sensorium should receive Gideon's beacon signal, though it will be weak. We need Squad Gideon to secure the breaching zone. Locate them as quickly as possible. When you are successful, proceed to secure the landing area to establish the full bridgehead. Praise the Lion.
Okay, so essentially we are going in to find some of our lost battle brothers. So here's our librarian. Before we go in, can select his weapons and stuff now, because this is the first mission. We only have the Storm Bolter, which is that thing there, and it's like a it's almost like a mini rocket launcher. So the bolters, they fire, they're like a machine gun, but they fire rocket propelled explosive rounds, so they do shoot like little rockets. That's probably the best way to describe them. Obviously incredibly powerful, if it was a real weapon. And the other hand is what we have, is a melee weapon. So we start with a force sword. That's the default weapon. A force sword is essentially a special sword which he puts his magic power through it, which is why it's glowing, which makes it more powerful. Sort of a power fist. It's just basically a massive fist with an energy field around it, which kicks ass. So as you can see, it is a lot more powerful than the force sword. To the stats down here in the bottom right, and then the Lost Mace of Corswain, which in effect is the same as a power fist, it just looks different, and I got that because I pre-ordered the game, but it's the same as a power fist, it just looks different, but we're going to go with a force sword. We also have two battle brothers with us, brother Barakiel, I think he's called, and he is more of a heavy weapons guy, so he starts with an assault cannon, which is this huge minigun type weapon here, and a power fist. We can give him a storm bolter if we want, or lightning claws, which makes him a melee specialist, but we'll keep him with the assault cannon, I think. And then we also have brother Nathan, I don't know how you pronounce that, and he's our medic. The medics are called apothecaries, and essentially I don't see any reason why you would give him a power fist. Just the Narcithium. I can never pronounce these things. That is essentially like a Space Marine medipack for all intents and purposes. I won't bore you with what it actually is supposed to do, but in this game it just heals you. So he's our healing man. He's our medic, and he can have lightning claws as well, which means he loses his healing, which renders him pointless, so he may as well have the storm bolter. Okay, so here we go. Let's deploy. So off we go into the Space Hulk. And remember, the Space Hulk is lots of different spaceships melded together. So off we go.
In position.
So we are actually in a... it looks like an Imperial Navy. In fact, sorry, no, it's Adeptus Mechanicus.
Command Barakiel to follow you. He will protect your back.
Okay, so I've done that now, so they're on their way. So they'll just follow me around. The AI on this game, I've seen people complaining about it. It's fine, as far as I'm concerned. Oh, he wants me to do it this way. That's a bit silly. There
so,
we go.
We start seeking for Gideon, squad. We're sending Gideon's beacon channel to you. Swift vengeance.
Okay, so it's over there. Retrieve Gideon. Yeah, so these guys will follow me around. They'll fight by themselves. They'll defend themselves. I can give them some rudimentary orders, like open doors, close doors, move there, etc., etc. But for the most part, they'll look after themselves. Yeah, so this is, like I was saying, an Adeptus Mechanicus ship. So for all intents and purposes, again, I try not to bore you with all the lore, but in the Imperium, technology is... They kind of think it's got a spirit. They call it the machine spirit. And essentially, there is a cult, like a church, if you like, which worships the machine. So they think, like, these weapons I'm carrying, the armor I've all got spirits and souls, and they pray to them and everything. That's a dead end. Let's go back this way. The Adeptus Mechanicus is that church. It's you know, there'll be, if there's any 40k fans listening to me talking, it's not exactly as clear cut as that, but that's the easiest way to describe it. They worship the machine, and they think the machine is stronger than the flesh. So this spacecraft is an Adeptus Mechanicus spacecraft, so you won't see many luxuries or anything like that. You won't see anything that's, you know, it's all about the machine essentially. So you'll see worships, you know, churches and things all about the machine. Now the Adeptus Mechanicus, they are also the most technologically advanced, for the most part, in general, arm of the Imperium. So usually the Adeptus Mechanicus ships and troops and everything, they have the best weapons, the most reliable technology, etc., etc. And that's where we are. So in Space Hulk, you see, what we need to do is we need to make our way to Gideon. Now, this is trying to emulate the board game a little bit. In the board game, you are usually moving down thin corridors, and there are aliens, Tyranids, which is what we spoke about earlier, usually on board said Space Hulk, and of course there are Tyranids on board this space hulk because it's trying to be like the board game. Oh, let's just read this. So this is an Adeptus Mechanicus log. I think it acts as a checkpoint. So the Omnisar, which is saying here, knows all. I might even be saying that wrong, but I've always pronounced it Omnisar. Knows all and comprehends all. The Omnisar is the machine god who they worship. So if you want to read that, feel free to do so. Pause the video, but we'll move on. Okay. So, yeah, as I was saying, I'll just quickly go to the map. So you can see here, this is the Space Hulk. Sorry, this is the section of the Space Hulk. You've got to remember the Space Hulk is vast. So this is the one ship that we are in at the minute. We started here. We are currently here. These corridors, which are a lighter blue, is what we've explored or what we know about. These areas we haven't been to. We're trying to get to here. Now, there are dead ends. There are doors which won't work. There are different routes to get there. So we can't just maybe make a beeline there because we might not get there. We also might not find out that there's a dead end or something until we actually get there either. Now these symbols here are detected, where we think aliens are going to come from. And when I say aliens, I mean Tyranids, the like insect monsters that we spoke about earlier. So we think they're access ports where the gene stealers will come from. So we've detected gene stealers on board. Gene stealers are a type of Tyranid. And yeah, so we're just trying to make our way to Gideon at the minute. So here we are, as you can see. It's all very kind of gothic and churchy. And yeah, the real star of the show, and this isn't my quote, it's from Rock Paper Shotgun, but I 100% agree with it, in this game is the Space Hulk. Whoever designed these levels has done an absolutely awesome job of conveying what it's supposed to be like. If you read the 40k books, if you look at the artwork and things, this honestly is like going into, well, my imagination when I'm reading the books and you know, playing the other games in the universe. They've done an absolutely outstanding job. So as you can see, this looks like a bit of a church. This pews, etc., and they're all pointing towards this huge bell and machine. They're worshipping the machine. Anyway, let's move on. So we'll try down here. Now it's blocked. So as you can see, the map says we can go that way, but we can't. So there are dead ends, etc. Now, that might not seem like a big deal, or you just go around the other way, but when there's aliens everywhere, and they're all trying to claw your face off, you know, and you're trying to get to a particular objective, then it can become quite important that you go in the right way. So what can we do? So we can zoom in, like so. We can sprint. Oh, I've just come back here. We can order our guys around. And we can shoot, and we can use our sword, and all sorts. We should really be going that way, shouldn't we? So let's see. Yeah, so let's go this way. Now, there are, on every level, at least I think it's every level, because bear in mind I haven't finished this game in any stretch of the imagination, 5 other relics that you can get. And they're just like collectibles, but what happens is at the end of the level you get a score, depending on how many relics you found, how accurate you were, etc., etc. It looks like there's been some badness going on this spaceship. And that score directly relates to how many, like, oh, do you see that? There were some aliens there. And you see the scanner in the bottom right is flashing red, so that gives you an indication of where bad guys are coming from. But the levels is kind of building up the atmosphere for us a little bit. So yeah, as I was saying, at the end of the level, you are given a score. And that, we need to go down this way, that directly relates to how many level up points you get. Oh, looks like we're having a bit of a vision. So we got some dead gene stealers there. Quite a few dead gene stealers, and one of our battle brothers dead. Covered in blood, so it looks like he did a good job.
Lets me see a prediction of the future.
No, it's not going to be a prediction, that. It's going to be fine. Let's open this door. Now, what you can do with these doors is, obviously, I can open it. Oh. Well, that's just ironic, isn't it, that I said that and you can open it. Well, what you can do is you can open them, close them, but you can also lock them permanently, which obviously stops aliens getting through. But then if you want to open it again, you need to smash it down. But because this is blocked, we can't open it, so we're going to have to smash this one down. So there we go. But you can actually do that yourself, lock doors behind you to try and cut off routes, etc. Okay, let's try and go this way. Oh, you see that then?
Brothers, are you clones of the Xenos?
Indeed, Xenos is Space Marine speak for aliens. So if you hear the word Xenos, that's what they're talking about. Aliens. Anything that isn't human, essentially. I don't want to go that way. Let's carry on this way. So yeah, so normally it's a good idea to go and find these other relics, so you get extra bonus points at the end, which then means you get more level up points, essentially. But for the sake of the video, we won't go off and do that. Can I smash this down? I can. You see, the last time I did this, I didn't come this way. Wow. That's a dead Space Marine. Well, they put up a good fight.
May their shades fight on for a while. An apothecary team is going to retrieve their Prokenite lands once the bridgehead is established. They will live on in Bobland. I have an anomalous signal return. Verify it first.
Oh dear. Yeah, so when what I was talking about there was when a Space Marine dies, so we need to go and check out this anomalous signal. But when a Space Marine dies, what they do is they take out these special glands, which is grown in every Space Marine, and those glands are then put into another human, and those glands turn said human into a Space Marine, and that's how they make more. So it's precious that when a Space Marine dies, they recover that gland, those glands, because otherwise they will die out, essentially. Okay. This is it. Oh dear, he's dead. What's this? Okay, so major relics. This is one of the relics that I was talking about. Now, I think on every level there is a major relic at least. And if you collect them all, then I guess something happens, but I don't know anything about that. We found the Scepter of Power, so good for us. Willpower increased.
Sensorium is showing multiple returns in your area.
I don't know what
vigilant.
Willpower actually does, I must admit. Right, so we're getting red on our scanner. Wouldn't be surprised if bad guys are going to be on their way. Is that a turret? Now then, what we can do is we can actually hack this turret. Oh, it's actually... What I'm going to do is I'm going to destroy it, because for some reason in this game, turrets... You would think a turret would be a good thing, you know, if you hacked it or something along those lines, that it would fight for you, but they don't. They just shoot anything. In fact, I think they just shoot Space Marines. It's a weird part of the game, and something which I hope changes, actually, because the turrets right now, there's absolutely no reason to do anything with them other than destroy them, as far as I can tell. Where are we going here? Going the wrong way. Where do we need to go? Ah, there. I wanted to check whatever reading they found there. Okay, so that was back where we came. Okay, let's do some sprinting. Now on the right hand side, next to the Space Marine paper doll, as they call it, on the right-hand side, you'll see there's two bars. The blue bar is my sprint, essentially, so you see it goes down as I sprint, so I can't sprint forever, sadly. But sprinting is actually a way to fight enemies. You can just charge into them and smash them down. So that's why that is. The yellow bar on the left is my fervor, I think it's called, and that is essentially how well I'm doing. So the higher the fervor, the better the points I get, I think, at the end of the level. Now you'll see, looks like we're going into this wind. To check out this anomalous reading, this doesn't look good, guys. You'll see in the bottom there is 1, 2, 3, and 4. Those are my like magic powers, my psycho powers, for intents and purposes. Oh, here they are. Like a lightning spell. Crap, I've run out of bullets. Get stuck into them. Let's reload. Let's back up. Now, there is no friendly fire on this game, which is good. I can't hurt my teammates, but they do block my fire. Is everyone alright? Now at the bottom left hand side of the screen you'll see the health of everybody. Everybody's okay so far. Not really sure where we're supposed to be going now. This way.
Activate the defense grid at any cost. Our foes approach quickly. We must reactivate your defensive systems to secure the grid.
Okay, so we need to activate the generators. We need to bring power back to the ship, so. Because, of course, what we're trying to do here is establish a beachhead. Somewhere secure that we can continue our venture into the space hulk. This is obviously just the first foray in, and we want to go deeper, because as you heard in the introduction, there is a ancient Dark Angel spaceship in the center, which they want to get to for artifacts or secrets or whatever. There is the Dark Angels, the Space Marines. The Dark Angels have a dark secret, and I won't bore you with all that. Feel free to look it up. But yeah, in a nutshell, if they find anything from the past, they are interested. Well, okay, I will bore you, why not, while we deal with these. So, I do love that assault cannon. It just sounds cool. It looks cool. Whoa, looks like that barrel exploded. Yeah, so I won't go into detail, but in a nutshell, in a very, very quick way of explaining it, the Dark Angels, way back when, we're talking millennia ago, some of them betrayed the Imperium. They turned to the bad side. They turned bad. And that is a big, big no-no in the Imperium. You just don't do it. Because if you are a traitor, or a heretic, as it's also known, then you are just hunted down. Kind of like and Space Marine chapters, you know, even though they are the elite of the elite, even though they fight to the death for the Imperium, they aren't impervious to turning to the bad side, or making bad decisions, or getting mixed up in something that they shouldn't do, or being manipulated. It has resulted in some Space Marine chapters being excommunicated and essentially on hunted down and destroyed and killed for being heretics or traitors. So, as you can imagine, the Dark Angels, who are fiercely loyal, to have some of their number, to have some of their own brothers betray the Emperor and betray Imperium, even though it was millennia ago, is completely and utterly horrendous. They just can't even fathom it. But what happened was, is those Space Marines which did betray the Dark Angels and the Imperium, they were kind of found and nearly caught, but they all ran away into the immaterial, into the warp, which is what we spoke about earlier. And as we know, as we said, the warp doesn't have any time doesn't exist there. So even though it was millennia ago, they are actually still alive and still operating today, because they come out of the immaterial mirror now and do stuff. Because are they bad? Are they good? You don't know. Each traitor Space Marine of the Dark Angels, you know, had their own reasons for doing what they did, and blah blah blah. But today's the modern Dark Angels, and ever since then, they have been searching for them, and they call them the Fallen. So these Space Marines which betrayed them millennia ago, which are still operating and still out there, they're referred to as the Fallen. And it's a secret. They haven't told anybody, they haven't told the Imperial authorities that they had some of their number betray the Imperium all that time ago. They didn't tell anybody. They hid it, they covered it up. And what they do instead now is that they spend their time fighting for the Imperium, but they're always looking for the Fallen. They're always looking for those traitors. Always. And they are so obsessed with finding the Fallen that often they might be in the middle of a battle, and if they find a clue to the Fallen, they'll just leave the battle and leave. And just leave the, you know, humans to die potentially if they were protecting them, because they're more interested in finding the Fallen and they're absolutely obsessed with it. So, as you can imagine, when they heard that there was a ancient spacecraft from millennia ago, an old Dark Angel spaceship in the center of the Space Hulk, that's why they got very interested and sent their elite of the elite to go and investigate it, because it might give them a clue to finding the Fallen. Now, that's usually the reason why the Dark Angels do this kind of stuff, but the truth is that who knows if this has got anything to do with the Fallen. I guess the plot of the game will spell that out as you go through it and complete the campaign, but that just gives you a bit of context why these guys would be so interested. There are a number of other reasons as well, like I've already spoken about, like they might find ancient technology and other things like that, but that's the main reason the Dark Angels usually like to investigate stuff from their past. So I hope that makes sense. Okay, let's turn on the generators and as such the defensive systems of this spacecraft. So yeah, so I've spoke a lot about 40k, I've spoke a lot about what Warhammer is, and etc. etc. And I can safely say
the activation of the generators has broken a dormant gene stealers.
There the aliens have been fighting. Okay. Okay, so let's get back to where we started. Because we need to get there and secure it. We need to make it there first. This is good. Oh dear. And yeah, as I was saying, I must admit, that the game looks, feels, sounds like I would expect a 40k game to sound and look and feel. They've, as far as I'm concerned, they've nailed it now, though. I'm sure there's people out there that say otherwise, but as far as I'm concerned, they've done an absolutely fantastic job with how these spaceships look and everything. However, how does the game play? So, you've been watching me play this forever long, you've been watching me play it. I'm sure you can already see that the actual game itself could become a little repetitive. Now, I've only played the first few missions, and you know, you are walking around environments such as this, they're all different, and as a fan of the world, you know, they're amazing to me. You know, because I understand that what that ship is and what this ship is and why it's cool to be going around there. But I imagine as someone who isn't versed in it at all, who doesn't really, you know, just wants a cool sci-fi shooter game, you know, you're just gonna feel like you're walking down corridors, I imagine. And that's quite cool. I've said that before. That is kind of the point, though, because that's what the space or board game's about. It's about trying to survive against insane odds in these closed environments. You gotta manage your little group of space marines properly so they'll survive. That's what the board game's about. You know, that's the thing. But I can imagine somebody who doesn't know space or who, like I say, just wanted a sci-fi shooter, finding this all a bit. Is that it? Is all you do? Now, you do walk around, you know, and you fight the gene stealers, and there are different gene stealers. So this is the level 1, of course, so we're just fighting the bog standard gene stealer. There's nothing fancy about these guys. They just run at you in swarms. They look pretty creepy, they make horrible noises. They're quite dangerous close up. They can't get you from range. They don't have any special skills. They're not big or anything. They are what they are. So yeah, but this is level 1. You know, this is what level 1. This is what level 1's are for, right? In games, they to introduce you to things. Let's not start too tough. However, later on, you will, like for example, the next level. Level 2, let's just have a quick look at this. Level 2, the next spaceship you enter, as remember the Space Hulk is all different spaceships smashed together, is a troop ship, an Imperial troop ship, which would have been carrying thousands and thousands of soldiers. And that has been infected by the Tyranids as well, by the Gene Stealers, and what you've got is these human Gene Stealer hybrids. And they carry weapons. So there's the normal Gene Stealers, which we've been fighting so far, and then you have kind of like humanoid, freaky looking Gene Stealers with you know, weapons, with rocket launchers and machine guns and laser guns, etc, etc. So that spices things up straight away, because you're not just fighting mindless you know, horde aliens that just run at you. You know, for all intents and purposes, they're kind of like fast zombies. That's probably a good comparison to make to other games and films and stuff. You're fighting a little bit more of an interesting enemy, you know, they've got weapons. Immediately that spices things up, like I say. And then later on, because there's all sorts of different Tyranids in the board game, etc., you'll be fighting Hive Tyrants, which are huge guys, Carnifexes, which are like big battle tanks. They are the massive, but the Hive Tyrants, they're also big, but they're intelligent and dangerous. There'll be perhaps lictors, which can go invisible, things like that. But the initial stages, from a fan service point of view, absolutely brilliant. I love all this. I do. As a big fan of the series, this is game 1. As a big fan of 40k, I love all this. I mean, it just looks amazing to me. Maybe it doesn't to you, I don't know, but it looks and feels like 40k. This is what it's about. And, you know, it's a bit of a slow starter. I do wonder as I say, if it would just all be a little bit dull. For somebody who doesn't know the world. Glory to the Lion! But not to me. I can certainly say that this game so far, in the few hours that I've played, is one huge piece of fan service. Now, I don't know what to say. I think I can look at this game objectively and I can say that, you know, it isn't the greatest game in the world. You know, it's not the most exciting or engaging. I haven't played on the harder difficulties. Maybe that's where the intensity is. You know, maybe if you put it on the most difficult setting, you know, you'll be fighting for your life. Every shot has to count. But most people aren't going to play on that. Most people are just going to play on normal difficulties or easy or maybe hard, but not super hard. I don't know. But I think most people play normal as always. And you know, it is what it is. You know, but let's reload. Okay, our heavy weapons guy's getting injured, I need to get him healed. Ah, crap. I'm nearly dead. Right, okay guys, heal our heavy weapons guy, please. Oh dear. Right, so the heavy weapons guy's been healed, but our actual medic is injured, and I'm nearly dead as well. And I can't just get him to heal me again. Heal me, please. Come on, heal me. It has a cooldown, so you can't just heal. There is a cooldown. Now that bar at the top, the calculation running, is how long we've got to survive until the beachhead is secured. And I think the calculation that is supposed to be running is how many more gene stealers there are left, kind of thing. Right, heal yourself, my friend. Okay, right, everyone's back to full health, good work. So you can see I've got 8 more heals left. So there's only a limited number of heals. Now, you can also, at any point, if I hit number 4, this is playing on PC of course, at the moment, if I hit number 4, you will do what's called a Psygate. Now, a space wizard, or a librarian, that's my name, but space wizard, which I am. They can teleport. They can just use their magic powers to teleport out and teleport these guys out with you, which is called a side gate. You basically create a gate to where everyone can walk through. So what you can do is you can walk back to your spaceship to a safe area, and you'll be all healed. You'll get all your medipacks back. You'll reload all your weapons if you know. You can actually go and change your loadout as well, so maybe on a future mission you find the assault cannon that guy's got some bad idea for whatever reason, and you want to switch to a different weapon like a flamethrower or whatever. You can do that by pressing before and warping out. Now my understanding is that you can only do that a limited number of times. What I don't know, and this is where the game fails to explain things, is how many times you can do that. I don't know what it tells me that. I've never run out, you know, it's not like the game said to me, you can't do it anymore, or whatever. But yeah, apparently you can only do it a limited number of times, and I think it's got something to do with that orange bar on the right next to the paper doll of the Space Marine. And I think if I was to use a Psygate, that bar would decrease. And if you remember, that is a measure of how well I'm doing. So I think by using the side gate, you use up some of that orange bar, which in turn decreases your score. And also, you know, once you've used up that bar, you then can't side gate anymore. I think that's what it is, but it's never explained. It's not explained in the tutorial, it's not explained at any point so far, which is stupid as far as I'm concerned. But yeah, so the main thing, the idea is not to Psygate out, because if you use Psygate and go and heal up and everything, then your score is impacted at the end of the level. You get less skill points to spend to upgrade your guys, etc, etc. So, just a word on that. So yes, you can, there is progress and progression in this game. You know, you can level up your character, and there are things you can do to like improve your companions here, your battle brothers, with skill points, etc. And you unlock more weapons. I mean, you saw at the start, it was like there was a big suite of weapons that could be equipped, but you don't get all those at the start. Okay, so we've done it. So there you go, there's the Fallen. They're the, what the Dark Angels refer to as the traitors, like I was explaining before. Okay, so there we go. So as you can see, I have received 3 fervor points for that, and those are like skill points. And there's my score. Now, I didn't find any relics, that was because I was doing this video and I didn't go off and search for them. But if you find more relics, you get a better score. Honor kills, so that's headshots, melee kills, or psychic kills, you get more points for doing that. You get points for total kills. You get, I think, Mechanicus Cult. I think you actually get... That's a good one. See, again, the game doesn't explain it. I would have thought that you would have got less points for damaging things, but because I did... It's weird. It says I did poor. But I don't know. I don't know about that one. Again, the game needs to explain itself. And there's Psygate not used, which is what I was just explaining. I didn't warp out at any point and go and get healed up, etc. So I got perfect score for that. And that's it. That's level 1 complete. So yeah, and I think that's essentially... Well, I'll tell you what, I'll show you a little bit of level 2. We've unlocked the Assault Cannon now. So maybe we could have a look at that, just if you want to. So as you can see, I've got 3 points because of my score from the previous level, and I can upgrade things. So what have we got here? So 10% armor. I'm not going to be able to get to that. One of our characters can equip the plasma cannon. And an extra psi power, which is like a fiery whirlwind. Okay, what we'll do, just for the sake of the video, we'll get the plasma cannon in play, and then we'll just increase that. So that's all my points spent. Okay, so let's
the ancient Dark Angel ship in the heart of the Space Hulk.
Let's let this guy talk.
Finding out that Squad Gideon had been slain,
while it loads,
a horde of Xenos as we conducted investigatory missions to uncover this enigmatic vessel from our dark and distant past. The Deathwing moved to secure entry into the old ship, while we overcame the energy and psychic defenses created by the Gene Stealers. Hard fought was the battle, but the bridgehead had been established, and progress to our objectives continued. We are the Emperor's Blade.
There you go. So, as you can see in the top left, we're now entering another ship called Cadia's Hand. Or Cadia's Hand. I've always pronounced it Cadia. And, I could talk to you about what Cadia is, but I won't.
We have encountered Gene Stealer hybrids armed with ranged weapons.
So this is what I was telling you about
launching
before.
Launching counterattacks against the perimeter, threatening the integrity of the landing zone on the Alethros. Looking at our scan data, the Tech Marines have advised that the hybrids may be able to sever the ship where our squads are currently located, to propel it into the gravity well of the nearby planet. To prevent this, we must disable the propulsion system in this sector. If the enemy succeed, we will be forced to withdraw and return in another costly breaching assault.
Okay.
Precious time and lives will be wasted. The Emperor abhors failure.
Okay, so there we go. So we'll have a look at this level. And this is, so Cadia, very, very briefly. Cadia is a fortress world, and it essentially the entire world is devoted to raising armies, and it is also a world which defends a very critical part of the Imperium, which again I won't bore you with, but Cadia, lots of normal human troops, not space marines, come from there. Millions and millions and millions, and they're like very, very highly trained, and they're a good force in the Imperium of normal human troops. And the ship that we are about to go into is one of theirs, so it's a troop ship. However, it's obviously become part of this Space Hulk, and everyone's dead, apart from Gene Stealers. Those aliens are now the hybrids that I spoke to you about. Okay, so we'll give Brother Barakiel the plasma cannon, which is like a, it shoots, it's like an incredibly powerful weapon, but it doesn't shoot very quickly, and he can stay as he is. Okay, so this is us in our like little safe chamber. There's a side gate, look, so we are now going to, so I think actually, no, I was just going to say, I think this is actually on the ship that we just created our bridgehead on, but I'm not convinced it is, but anyway. So off we go, on to mission 2. So we'll just do a little bit of this just so you can see the slightly different enemies. So we're going down on a lift. So this is plasma cannon. I haven't equipped the assault cannon because I know that it's a bad idea.
We have to quickly destroy the archaeotech engine. Nothing could be done hastily and prudently in Robert Abigail. So answers an apothecary.
The assault cannon's a bad idea in this level because you're fighting against ranged guys and it's not very accurate. So, yeah, so again, fan service, that's a sentinel. That is something that normal human troops use. So the Cadians are one regiment of billions, and the human forces, not space marines, of the Imperium are referred to as the Imperial Guard. So this is an Imperial Guard ship, which is where normal human troops would have been. So yeah, let's just do a little bit of this level, so I'm maybe run into some of these hybrid troops so you can see that they're a little bit different. You know, they have weapons, they're kind of humanoid, there they are. So we've got the jump on them there, so there was no problem there. But there's also the other kind of aliens as well, the Gene Stealers, not just the hybrids. So the game starts mixing things up straight away. Got it. So far so good. Oh, that blue flash is the plasma cannon. Are we going the wrong way? I think I'm going the wrong way. Oh, there we are, normal Gene Stealers. So this is the thing you need to remember with this game, you need to really pay attention where you're going. Because you can get lost. So yeah, we've got a mixture of both here. Let's see, he's got like a gun he was shooting at us then. The normal guns aren't too much of an issue, it's when they have the heavy weapons. And you'll hear your battle brothers shout out when they see a heavy weapon, like a rocket launcher or a stubber, which is like a heavy machine gun. But yeah, so it's, even though the enemies have changed, and even though we're doing a different mission, as you can see, it's a similar kind of environment. And this, to my eyes, is a very different environment. The ship is different, the surroundings are different, you know, the things that you see, the different emblems and icons on the walls and stuff, they're all different, and it makes sense to me. We are actually in a different place in my head, because I know the lore, you know, I read the books, etc. But somebody else would just probably see, I'm in the same bloody kind of ship. It just looks all the same. It's corridors, it's, you know, it's pipes, etc, etc. You know what I mean? And I think that's where... oh, God. You know, it's all the same. And it looks very similar to the untrained eye. And the untrained eye is what most gamers are going to be. And can you blame the game for that? No, because it's set in the 40k universe. It's gonna, this is the way it is. This is what Space Hulk looks like. If it was something else, I don't know, something not like this, then it wouldn't be Space Hulk. It's as simple as that. So you know, people, if you're looking at this and you're thinking you do like it or you don't like it, you need to make yourself okay with the fact that most of the game, and I haven't finished the game so I can't say for certain, but I think it's fair to say most of the game is going to be in environments like this, you know? And we're only in the early stages of the game. There are, I know for a fact that there are bosses, you know, there are like bigger, scarier tyrannids, the horns get bigger, the weapons that you have get more interesting. There's quite a few of them. There we go. You know, you get more powers, you get more powerful, etc, etc. So, yeah, so there we go. So I think I'll leave it there. There's a little Rik Look at Space Hulk Deathwing. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions or comments, do put them, well, in the comments. And yeah, there we go. Space Hulk Deathwing, everybody. I personally like it because I am a big 40k fan, but I can understand people that might be looking at this and thinking, ooh, this looks a bit dull or weird or whatever. So yeah, I hope you liked the video regardless. Thanks a lot. Take care. See you next time. Bye-bye.